So we figured out that this was arithmetic because the variable is not in the exponent. So how do I find my first term? Megan. I put the lower limit for I in my formula, right? So 32 plus 4 times 1 minus 1. 1 minus 1 is 0 times 4 is 0 plus 32 is 32. So my first term here is 32. Okay? Then in my sum formula, I also need a sub n. How do I find a sub n in my sum formula? Claire? I plug in the upper bound this time. So that's going to be 32 plus 4 times 9 minus 1. 9 minus 1 is... 8 times 4 is 32 plus 32 is 64. Okay, what else do I need to find my arithmetic sum? N. I need N. How do I find N, Ben?
Upper minus lower. Plus 1.
Upper, so 9 minus lower is 1, and then plus 1, so that gives me 9 there, correct? Okay, so my sum of those first 9 terms is going to be 9 divided by 2 times 32 plus 64. 32 plus 64 is 96. 9 halves times 96 is like 48 times 9. 2, carry the 7, 432. Yes? Okay. Fantastic. Okay. Second one then, now judging by that, what we talked about before, since the exponent has the variable, this is a geometric sequence. So I have 2 from my half sheet then. I've got this one down here, and I've got this one up here. In either case, I need G sub 1. So how do I find G sub 1? Plug in the lower bound into... I'm just going to deal with this part right here, okay? We'll deal with the multiplying by 5 here in a minute, okay? So plug in the lower bound into my formula, then that's going to be 4 to the 0 power. What's 4 to the 0 power? 1. Fantastic. That's 1. In both of my formulas, I need R. What is R? Megan? 4. It's what we're taking the exponent of. So R is 4. Okay? Now, here's where two paths diverge in the woods. Okay? And you can take whichever one you want. Okay? If you're going down the one path, you would need to find G sub n. And to find G sub n, you're going to take the upper bound and plug it into your formula, and you're going to get that G sub n is 64. If you take the other path, you would need to find n. And n is going to be upper minus lower plus 1, which is 4. Okay? So if you follow this path, then you would say that G sub 1 is, so the sum of the first 4 terms is going to be G sub 1 was 1 times R to the n power minus 1 all over r minus 1. If you follow this path, it would be the sum of the first four terms would be g sub n times r minus g sub 1 all over r minus 1. Okay. In either case, you're going to get 256 minus 1 all over 3, and that is equal to 255 over 3. Actually, put that into, oops, this way, this into that color. Okay. Then 255 divided by 3 is what? 85. Okay. Just let me rewrite this quick. So the sum of the first four terms then would be 256 minus 1 all over 3. That we said was 255 over 3. So that's the sum. But then we have to multiply that by 5. And 5 times 85 is 425. Okay? Good to go on that? Okay? Now, we're going to be out of the textbook today on page 503. Okay? We're starting section 6.4. We're going to do 6.4 today. We'll finish up with section 6.4 tomorrow. Okay. We're going to be talking today about a concept called an infinite geometric series. An infinite geometric series is a geometric series that continues or that goes on forever. Okay? There is no stopping it. It just keeps going. Okay? Now, geometric tells me that what are we doing to get that next term? We're doing what, Max? We're multiplying to get that next term. Okay? So we're going to keep multiplying forever and ever and ever. Okay? And today, we're going to look at the sum of those infinite series. And we're going to see if we can determine what's going on there. We can find out how we can add the sum of those infinite series. Geometric series. Okay? So, looking here at question number 1 from problem number 2. Examine the given formula and accompanying diagram for each infinite geometric series. Identify both R and G sub 1 for each series. Then, determine if the sum is infinite or finite. And if it's finite, we're going to estimate. Okay? If it's infinite, it's going to go to infinity. Okay, so let's look at number 1 here. What is R in part A? What is R in part A? 1/3. How'd you come up with 1/3, Claire? So it's right there. Okay, in sigma notation. Okay, that works too. What's another way to come up with the fact that R is 1/3? Okay, we have to multiply by 1/3 to get there. Okay, what's another way to come up with the fact that R is is one-third. No. Max? That's what Megan just told us. There's one other way to find R. Remember? Nope. One other way to find R. I can take any term, divide by the previous one right before it. So my other way is I could take any term and divide it by the term right before it. Okay? All three ways get me the fact that R is one-third. Okay? What is my first term then? How did we come up with a first term of one-third? Because it's the first term listed in the when we write it out, or nope, there are dot dot dots. I see them right there. What's the other way? Plug in the lower bound in sigma notation. We plugged in G sub 1 here is equal to 1/3 to the first power. Okay? That's how we found, that's the two ways to find the first term. Three ways to find R, two ways to find the first term. Okay? So, now, this is the little confusing part about parts A, B, C, and D, and E. Okay? So what they're saying here is if you took the sum of the first term, it would be 1/3. One-third is one-third. Okay? If you took the sum of the first two terms, it would be 4/9. Thirteen-twenty-sevenths here. Okay. See that? We keep adding. When we keep adding those parts, okay? Now, if I would add the next term, that would be adding 1/81, which is like adding that much of a sliver to it. Okay? And then if I take the next term and I add the next one, it's going to be like adding 1/243, right? And I take the next one, and it's going to be adding 1/729, and so on and so forth, right? Okay? So can we estimate that sum if we take that pattern all the way out to infinity? Are we going to ever fill in that circle? So we're never going to get to 1. Are we even going to get to 3/4? Because we went the next 2 and we basically added to there, right? And now we're adding, the next one was adding 1/729. That's teeny, teeny tiny, right? Okay. So could we estimate what this sum is going to be? So it's probably going to be a little bit bigger than 1/2, right? Right? Because we're almost to 1/2. Is it going to make it to 2/3? Is it going to make it to 3/4? What do you think? So somewhere between 1/2 and 2/3. right? That's an estimate, right? Do I have to be dead on accurate? No, it's an estimate.
Okay. Somewhere between.
Okay. Let's go to part B now. There's part B. What's our R value? How'd you come up with 3?
It's the one in the parentheses.
It's got the exponent attached to it. Okay? Because I could have also put 1/3 in parentheses there too. You know what I mean? So I can't just go with it's got parentheses. Okay? So it's got the exponent. It's the base of the exponent term. What's another way of finding 3? Ben? So I multiply by 3 to get the next term? Okay? What's the other way to find 3? Term divided by the term right before it gets me 3. All of those are equal to 3. Love it. G sub 1. Ben? So that's... Okay. So what is it? 1. Okay. And you might have said it and I missed it. Okay. So the first term is 1, right? Okay. If I put the lower bound of 1 in there, 3 to the first power is 3 times 1/3 is 1. If I look at the list, it's the very first term. It's 1. Okay. So if I take the first 4 sums, okay, so the sum here is going to be 1. The sum here is going to be 4. The sum here is going to be 13. The sum here is going to be 40. Okay. The fifth sum, if I went out to 5 terms, that would be 40 plus 81 would be the next term. So that would be 121. And if I continue that on, what's that going to go to? It's going to keep getting bigger each time, right? So my infinite sum is going to be infinity. Okay? What I'd like you and or your shoulder partners to do now is, I'm going to give you about 7 minutes. I don't think you'll need it, but I'm going to give you a little time here to do C, D, and E. Okay? Same thing. Find the R, find the G sub 1, find the estimate the final sum. Okay? So, in C, what did we come up with for the R value? 3/4. I like 3/4. Okay. What do we come up with for the first term? 1. And did we have an estimate as to what that sum would be? Between 4 and 6? Between 4 and 5? Between 3.5 and 4? Let's bring it, let's go, so somewhere between, oops, I forgot the word between. Whoa, hey now. I can forget once in a while. So somewhere between, if we went 3.5 and 4.5, would you be okay with that, Max? Is that okay with you? Everybody good with everybody else? Somewhere between 3.5 and 4.5? Okay, all right. D, R value. 1/4. First term, also 1/4. Can we estimate the sum? probably somewhere between a quarter and a half, right? Oops, that's a bad half. Bad two. Like that two better. Agree? You good with it, Skye? You were just giving me the look like, I don't know.
Yeah, like, I was trying to see where I could see it.
Oh, I see. I gotcha. Okay? R value in E. 3/2. First term. 1. Estimate. Because in two slides, you're not going to have to write estimate anymore. You know what I mean? Okay? Agree with that one. Because each term is going to get bigger, so the next term, when I add it on, it's going to make the whole sum even bigger. And it's never going to get smaller and smaller and smaller. The only way that I can get smaller and smaller and smaller is if I end up at infinity adding 0. Okay? Or something very close to 0. Okay? So, analyze the common ratio for each series in question number 1. Part A, what do you notice about series with infinite sums? That was B and E. B and E had the infinite sums. Okay? So, what did we notice about R in those cases? It was bigger than 1. Is that what you're going to say, Max? Okay. So, in both of those cases, R was greater than 1. And in both of those cases, the sum ended up being infinity. Okay? We call those divergent sequences or divergent series. When R is greater than 1, we call those divergent series. Okay? And we can't find the sum, because the sum of a divergent series is infinity. Okay? What did we notice about the ones with finite sums? So that was like A, C, and D. What did we notice about the R values there? It was less than 1. Still positive though, right? Okay, so it was between 1 and 0. We call these convergent series. Okay. So those are convergent series. And the reason I say that is because the very next thing talks about convergent and divergent series. A convergent series is an infinite series that has a finite sum. Okay? Means that when you're adding that term at the infinity, you're basically adding something that's so small, it's like adding 0. Okay? you're adding one more piece of sand to the beach. Okay? Yes, you're increasing the sump, but you're really not changing the landscape at all. Okay? A divergent series is an infinite series that does not have a finite sum. If a series is divergent, the sum is infinity. Okay? But if the series is convergent, then the sum can be computed using that formula right there. And that formula is also down here on your sheet with a typo. On your half sheet, note sheet, it's S sub N. It should just be S down there. It shouldn't be S sub N on your half sheet. It should just be X down there. Okay? S denotes the sum for a infinite series. Okay? S sub N denotes the sum for a certain amount of terms. Okay? So it should just be S on there. That's my fault, my bad. I will take full credit for that mistake. Okay? So all you need, if we're going to infinity, because if I go to infinity, if I look at my other two formulas, if I look at S sub N equals G sub N times R minus G sub 1 all over R minus 1, or if I look at G sub 1 times R to the N power minus 1 over R minus 1, my two hiccups come right here. I can't figure out that infinite term, because I can't put infinity into my rule. Or on the other one, it comes right here, because I can't take R to the infinity power, because infinity doesn't exist. Okay? So that's why we had to come up with a third rule for infinite series. Okay? So let's go back now and let's actually compute what those were. Okay? So in part A, here's the recap of part A. So we first need to determine if it's convergent or divergent. Convergent, we can find the sum. Divergent, the sum is infinity. That's why we have to determine that. So we look for the R value. What is the R value again from part A? It's 1/3. Okay, so is 1/3 greater than 1? You guys remember how to tell if a fraction is bigger than 1? No? No? If the top is bigger than the bottom, it's bigger than 1. Okay? If the top is bigger than the bottom, the fraction is bigger than 1. If the bottom is bigger than the top, the fraction is less than 1. Okay? So, bottom is bigger than the top, so this fraction is less than 1. So, is this a convergent or divergent series? It's a convergent series. So, therefore, I can use the formula S equals G sub 1 divided by 1 minus R to actually calculate what the sum is. We estimated it back at the beginning to somewhere between 1/2 and 2/3. Okay? So what is my first term? 1/3. What is my R value? That's also 1/3. Okay? So what is 1 minus 1/3? That's 2/3. Now, without a calculator, if I've got 1 of something, okay, and I divide it by 2 of that same something, what's my fraction? one of something, and I divide it by two of that same something. I have half of whatever it is, right? Or I just have a half, right? Okay? So, 1/3 divided by 2/3 gives me 1/2. Okay? And so our estimate was actually a little bit high. We were on the low end of our estimate. Okay? Part B. Is that a convergent or divergent series? Why is it divergent? What's my R value? My R value is 3. 3 is bigger than 1, so it is divergent. So my sum is automatically infinity. I can't calculate the sum of the infinite amount of terms in that one because it keeps growing. Okay? You now figure out exactly what the sums are for C, D, and E. First one, convergent or divergent? Convergent. Why is it convergent? R value is 3/4, and that is less than 1. So the sum is going to be my first term divided by 1 minus R. My first term was 1. 1 minus 3/4 is 1/4. 1 divided by 1/4 is 4. 4/4 and a dollar. This part right here? So 4 over 4 minus 3/4. Common denominator.
Oh, okay.
Okay? Right? And then this one would have been 1 times 4 over 1.
I was thinking about it.
Okay. Yep. Common denominators. Okay? All right? D, convergent or divergent? Convergent. R value? 1/4. So that means then that my sum is going to be my first term, which is 1/4, divided by 1 minus 1/4, because 1/4 is my R. So that's going to be 1/4 divided by 3/4, which is going to be 1/3. Both of those fell within our estimated range, right? Okay, so we're good there. Part E, convergent or divergent?
Divergent.
Why is it divergent? Top is, so my R value here was 3/2. Top is bigger than the bottom, so that means the sum is infinity. Okay? Again, a couple of reminders. First off, okay, homeworks due this week are going to be purple, cream, and brown. Okay? ACT prep sessions are still tonight. 3 to 5 tonight and 7 to 9 on Monday. Test is a week from today on chapter 6. Okay?